that what Dominic Cummings has done hasn't had one bit of, made one bit of difference. Because if you look at the pictures in the newspapers today and over the last couple of days, at people trundling down to all
that's
the beaches.
That's not the point, Janet. The point is we were in lockdown and he should not have travelled that distance, full stop. He broke the law in that respect.
But he was in a car with his wife and children.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter.
Oh, I feel sorry for him, honestly, because he's damned if he does and he's damned if he doesn't.
Why do you feel sorry for him?
I just do. I just think, you know, they were in the car, the four of them, going for a drive or whatever, not hurting anybody, self-isolating in the car so they couldn't affect anybody else and that.
But so many people could have done that up and down this country, but they were told you can't.
I'm sure lots of people have done it.
But he is a member of this government laying down the law for people and he's flouting it while so many millions of people in this country respect it in despite of really horrendous situations. And I'm passionate about this because I had a friend last week whose father died in hospital and she couldn't go and visit him. And that is, I'm sorry, it's not one rule for one of us and another rule for them. That is not right. You don't do that in a time of crisis. And he should resign because that's the kind of leaders I want. I want human beings, respectful of other people's...
Maggie Thatcher was a prime minister who never said sorry. And Maggie Thatcher, in so many ways, was good for this country and she also had her shortcomings. Yeah. I think you're projecting something onto Dominic Cummings that he
just does not see it.
I mean, you might find it uncomfortable.
Well, I just thought of it in a different way, really. I felt really sorry for Charles.
I don't know if I can say sad for him because at the end of the day, you know, there's a lot of people that know he went into a marriage when there was kind of feelings for somebody else. And even at an interview that he did, and, you know, they said, oh, are you in love? I remember they asked Diana if she was in love, and he says, well, whatever love is. That's not nice for a girl.
No, I understand
next
that.
To your prince.
But they're the royal family, and there's a protocol that they have
there's
to go
through. There's a protocol,
through.
But there's also... He could have told her, you know what, there's somebody there in the wings, you're not going to have my heart. Give her that. She deserved to know that before she went down the aisle, because then she might have made a different decision.
Well, let me just address what Nadia's just said. Sure. Nadia has said that she believes that we as a human race have lost the ability to kind of control ourselves. I completely disagree with that. This whole documentary is about the fact that, yes, there are these, you know, issues that are out there in this world. It's about taking personal responsibility. Every single platform that is mentioned on that, Google, Facebook, Twitter, they are all free platforms. This is a personal choice for you to go in and take part. And when you take part, every single platform gives you security, notifications. You can turn them on and off. It gives you privacy. You have to set those settings. So if you are not engaging in the whole application and you're just mindfully going on about it, you have to take personal control.
Haven't watched the film. Mm. And yes, I agree with what you've said, but when you watch the film and you watch the level of control way beyond, because how many people are actually completely in control of what they're watching?
No, but Nadia, I don't need to watch the film because my husband works in the whole... I don't, because what you're saying, it says that we as human beings are out of control. We are not. Yeah. Now, let me just give you an example. No, we're not, because when you're not, because what you're not in control of is actually your own feelings and your own understanding.
But so I think when you're a celebrity, there is a trade-off. You know, there's a lot of things that happen when you're a celebrity. You get into nice restaurants maybe ahead of everybody else, you get freebies, etc. And part of the trade-off is that you do lose a bit of your privacy. And I think that, particularly if you're a young celebrity, I think it's right that Kelly has come out and said this, because there will be young followers on social media who will see that she's lost weight, see that she's looking great. And she has also put in effort on the back of this operation as well. It's not just the operation. But I think you have to be honest. And it's something her mum has always been. Sharon Osbourne has always said, I don't look like this naturally. I've suffered surgery to look like this.
Yeah, but how far does that you have to be honest extend? I mean, we're talking about this.
Not if it's a medical issue. If you have a very serious medical issue that isn't something that other people are going to want to emulate, then absolutely you don't have to say anything. Well, a gastric band, But I think, particularly as a lot of celebrities do DVD fitness things and they do diet deals.
We lie all the time if you look at it that way. I mean, how many airbrush photographs have we had of ourselves that go out there?
But you know
they always say that they would be an airbrush?
You know they're airbrushed.
No, no, you don't. We don't always declare.
Sorry, let's get Carol's opinion here. What do you think, Carol?
Well, I think they're being a bit hypocritical as well. I think they want their cake and eat it all the time. They just want, you know, whatever they want, they get, they have. And I'm, frankly, I'm not interested in them as a couple anymore. I just think, you know, they should go over there and be what they want to be. And I won't be watching the show. I'm just 100% bored with the pair of them, to be honest.
Brenda.
But the thing is, you know, you say that they want their privacy, but yet again, they're in the media is talking about it. They're in the US, but the UK media are still talking about it. They're never going to get their privacy. They never had their privacy from the first off because of who he was marrying.
But they could get privacy. You know, come on, Brenda, you know that. They could get privacy. They've chosen to live in LA. Mm-hmm. Which is the biggest kind of, you know, microscope of showbiz in the world. They've chosen to live in a very large, expensive house, which means they're going to be the focus of attention, just like everybody else in that town that lives in big houses.
But you're saying strip them of their titles.
There are
Even
ways...
if they were stripped of their titles, people will still be following them around. A title doesn't mean anything about the person itself.
I don't necessarily agree. There are a lot of people that are members of or have been members of the royal family that now live outside of it, who live pretty private lives.
Yep.
Princess Margaret's children, you never see them. You know, they're out and about, they cycle places, they work for a living.
But they're not in a controversial marriage necessarily, are they?
Well, I don't necessarily think their marriage is controversial. I think they love each other.
I think they're in love with each other and I think they should just be allowed to be in love and raise their family. This is not about not being able to say,
I've moved away from Britain because the British people did not respect my privacy.
Yeah.
And then go to America and invade their own privacy.
Well, it's a Netflix thing. You've got a remote switch off if you want
to
switch
there.
Off.
You're nodding there. And the idea about, you know, what made Britain great, I think, is something that we really have to relook at. You know, we didn't just become a rich nation just by this tiny little island. How did we do it? We did it by going out to the world, conquering other nations and stripping them of their resources and giving them other things too, but at the same time making them feel second class. And so we've got to ask ourselves now, you know, why is it that all these people from different parts of the world feel a connection to this small island? It's because this small island was part of their lives for 200 years.
Yeah,
you know, exactly. in Indian circles.
Yeah, but Ranveer, then you're getting back to interpretation, and that is your interpretation, which I would happen to agree with in a lot of ways. But, you know, people coming from a different perspective will have a different perspective. You know, if you have a lousy breakup in a marriage and you ask the husband what happened and you ask the wife what happened, the facts will be the same. They'll have a completely different interpretation. And we have to deal with that.
There are facts, aren't there, in history, which are not taught. Like, you know, the famine in Bengal, which Churchill's behaviour affected. You know, the fact that Gandhi worked in South Africa and had a terrible view of black South Africans. You know, yeah,
Do you think people can make mistakes
in their lives. Yeah. We have to be honest about that.
We have to have the different perspectives. That's the trouble.
Yes,
I think too often we
do you think, Ranveer, there is a sort of cynical decision to leave out certain facts to misrepresent history?
I think there's blind spots because, like you said right at the beginning, it's who's telling the story. And I think that people who have been left behind have never had a chance to have power to tell those stories. And I think now that is a time to change. And I think people who have built up all their pain for years and years and years are now finally being heard. And I think that it has to change.
So history is written by the victors?
Yeah.
You have to wonder how many of these proposals were preceded by the scariest meeting in any man's life, asking a dad for his daughter's hand in marriage? Or is that one wedding tradition that is just totally outdated? I'm just going to glance to my left here. And I think I feel like I'm 100 years ago.
Ask for a hand in marriage. I mean, where are we? I don't understand anything. I mean, not that I would judge anyone that would want to do that, but I would find it such a turn-off if my fellow went to my dad and asked him...
Would you?
For my hand in marriage. Ask me. Don't go and ask somebody. I mean, I don't know whether this is just because it's in my
genetics.
Oh, she's getting angry.
It's in my roots because I come from a background where women's marriages were discussed without them being in the room. You know what I mean? My dad tells the amazing story of when he was growing up and he was very, very close to his younger sister, and the absolute highlight of their time, you know, growing up in the Middle East, was the weddings where they would dance and they would sing. And, you know, he's at this wedding one day and he was looking for his sister, looking for his sister. She was probably 13, 14, and she was one of the brides. She was the bride.
Moving it away from 13-year-old brides.
No, but I can't because that's where it comes from. Even when somebody, you know, like, I mean, hopefully we're all feminists, you know, we make our own choices, we follow our own dreams, and yet to still sit around and go, oh, well, I hope he asks me to marry him. What? You both decide together.
Nadia, I get what you're saying, and obviously with that cultural experience, I 100% support you. I am very glad that I'm in Glasgow and 500 miles away, because all of this is making me just a little bit nervous.
Hey, you have no idea. And I think what we have learnt since the last lockdown, which was in March, is that many people have put social distancing in place in the workplace. If we go to the shops, people's businesses, small businesses, manufacturing, they've done what the government says. They are practicing social distancing, they're wearing their masks, they've got hand sanitizers everywhere. And for me, I think we can't get rid of this. We have to learn to live with this safely. And also, I understand the government wants to protect the NHS. We cannot protect the NHS and we cannot fund the NHS if people are not working and keeping this economy vibrant. And that money goes to the NHS. And finally, my final point is this. Look, I'm okay. Lockdown doesn't affect me that badly. There are people in this country that are going to food banks, that can't pay the mortgage, that have got children that are dependent on them. They can't work, but they can because they're fit and healthy too.
Right.
That is not right. I feel that people who have paid their mortgages, have got comfortable homes, that, you know, lockdown's okay for them. It's not for the majority of people. And for future generations, we are absolutely destroying their futures. And I'm sorry, there has to be a balanced approach to this.
So you're saying you don't want lockdown to
happen? I don't want lockdown, no, I don't.
Gloria, you feel very strongly the other way.
I do, and I love Sarah dearly, and I'm sure lots of people up and down the country would agree with any point she makes, and maybe it's part to do with my age, but sometimes I think you cannot balance money against deaths. And the figures are escalating at an alarming rate, and you only have to look at Italy, Germany, Belgium, France to see the hospitals absolutely packed, people in corridors, they can't deal with it all. And Boris did not want to, here's me calling him just Boris, but anyway, Boris did not want to necessarily go into a national lockdown, but sometimes you have to. These figures are critical, and we have to try and break that circuit they talk about. We have to do something, and it horrifies me that 700 young people last night were at a rave in Bristol. And so there comes a point when we all, whether you're young, old, middle-aged, whatever, that you have to take this into your own hands and do something positive. And I feel really sorry for business people, but I was so glad to hear that furlough had immediately been continued, even though it was supposed to stop this weekend.
But we'll be... Gloria, I'm sorry, but we will be paying for that for in future, and I think that is really wrong.
But you know what,
I understand that not everybody is adhering to that, but I think this is where the government should step in and they should put more people on the streets to make sure that people are adhering to it.
But that shouldn't stop people from going on and making a living.
I think it's very hard for people
to say, I'm going to adhere to this when you've got members of parliament themselves that are not adhering. I mean, you've got Margaret Furrier, who came from Scotland. She had symptoms. She took a test, travelled all the way to London, went into parliament, found out the test results were positive, and she still travelled on public transport and went back and got a slap on the wrist for it. When people who are adhering and they're sticking to the guidelines as best as they can, putting up the plastic coverings.
But you cannot punish the whole nation for the actions of a few. This is serious.
It's actions of a few, but you've got to lead by example at the same time as well. And people, you're saying non-essential. You know, people's businesses, they're essential to those
those people that are running their small business. Just because, you know, you've got supermarket, you go into the supermarket, some people have got masks on, some people haven't got masks on.
But this is where
it's the people to take personal responsibility, and if you want to get out of this, then do something about it. If you're a member of parliament and you've been told to stick to these guidelines, stick to these guidelines